بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وبعد. So we all know and understand, and we've heard in many lectures and discourses, and we've been told by our teachers and our tutors and our mentors that pride and arrogance is a very evil trait. It is repugnant. It is deplorable in the eyes of the Almighty. Now, today I want to speak on the topic of pride, but from two different dimensions. The first thing is that many people are confused on the definition of pride. So some people think that you must refute and deny what you have, then you are humble. So if Allah's blessed you with beauty, no, I don't have beauty, I don't have beauty. Or Allah's blessed you with generosity, no, I'm not generous. Or Allah's blessed you with a good voice to recite Quran, no, I just have a regular, average, common voice, I don't have a beautiful voice. That is not humility, that is denying what Allah has given you. This is what the scholars have written. Pride is when you consider what you have, that because of this, I'm superior and others are inferior. I'm generous, so I'm better. You are not generous, so I am superior to you. I have a beautiful voice, hence my recitation is accepted in the court of Allah and yours is not. This is pride, this is repugnant, this is evil. The perception, the myth, the notion that I am superior. Al-kibru batru al-haqqi wa ghamtu al-nas. Denying the truth and to look down upon people. So that's the first thing we need to set the record correctly about. To deny the ni'mats that Allah has given you is not pride. Is not humility. By denying it, and you're not being humble. But rather, pride is where you perceive yourself to be superior. The second angle to this is that many people limit the meaning or the harm of pride to material and mundane things. So pride over your position, pride over your worldly accomplishments, pride over your empire, pride over your financial stability, etc. Surely that's evil, repugnant, deplorable, detestable. But then there's another type of pride, and perhaps more wicked than the former, and that is pride over your nobility and your piety. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks out against such people in the Quran in many places. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ يُزَكُّونَ أَنفُسَهُمْ. Have you not seen those people who claim piety, who purify themselves, who exonerate themselves, who trumpet themselves? فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Do not purify or exonerate or claim that you are innocent. هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى. Allah knows who fears him the most. Here's a quick reflection to see the Anbiya alayhim as-salatu was-salam and how humble they were and how fearful they were about the bounties of Allah, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could snatch or take back any bounty at any time. So in Surah Ibrahim, in the 13 Juz, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the supplication of Ibrahim alayhi salam. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا. And remember the time when Abraham said, oh my Lord, make this place, meaning Mecca, a place of safety and security. وَجْنُبْنِي وَبَنِيَ أَن نَعْبُدَ الْأَصْنَامِ. And protect me and my son from worshipping idols. This is Abul Anbiya, Ibrahim alayhi salam, and he is supplicating Allah. In Bayanul Quran, under this ayah, in Masailu Suluk, it is written, Dalla ala anna al-anbiya lam ya'manu ala anfusihim. The latter portion of this ayah, Ibrahim alayhi salam seeking protection for himself and his son from idolatry, asking Allah for protection, is a clear testimony that the Anbiya alayhim as-salatu was-salam lam ya'manu ala anfusihim. They did not feel that they were safe and secured. We know with certainty that Allah protected them and secured them because they were sent by Allah. But they within themselves still would beseech and implore Allah. If that is the supplication and the prayer of a Nabi, he is praying to Allah, the environment outside is idolatry and people are worshipping Allah, people are worshipping idols. So Ibrahim alayhi salam is imploring Allah. Then what about you and I? And this is the quotation I share with you. فَكَيْفَ بِمَنْ يَتَقَلَّبُ كُلَّ آنٍ بَيْنَ النَّفْسِ وَالشَّيْطَانِ. How about that person who's gripped by either his ego or he's shackled by the devil, كل آن in every moment. فلا ينبغي لأحد أن يغتر بحاله ولا بكماله. Hence this ayah releases a sharp warning that no person should be proud or arrogant over the religious position that Allah has given him, because Allah can snatch it at any time. Allah telling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the 15 juz in Surah Bani Israel in verse 86, وَلَئِنْ شِئْنَا لَنَذْهَبَنَّ بِالَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ ثُمَّ لَا تَجِدُ لَكَ بِهِ عَلَيْنَا وَكِيلًا. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if we want, we can snatch the revelation that we gave you. But it is the sheer mercy of Allah that He has conferred it upon you, and it continues to come upon you. Again, it's mentioned in the tafsir, فيه أشد الخوف على سلب ما رزق أحد من النسبة والكمال كيف ولا أحد أعز على الله تعالى من حبيبه صلى الله عليه وسلم فلما خوطب بهذا فأين غيره منه صلى الله عليه وسلم. In this ayah is a very strong warning, أشد الخوف على سلب ما رزق أحد, that Allah can snatch and seize any form of nobility and piety that Allah has given you. The Quran that Allah has conferred on your bosom, O Hafiz, the knowledge that Allah has confirmed upon you, O scholar of deen, the piety, O pious individual of deen, the generosity, فِيهِ أَشَدُّ الْخَوْفْ عَلَى سَلْبِ مَا رُزِقْ. Whatever piety Allah has given you, Allah can snatch it, Allah can seize it at any time. كَيْفَ وَلَا أَحَدْ أَعَزُّ عَلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى مِنْ حَبِيبِهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمْ. Why not when Allah addresses His messenger who is the best of His creation, فَأَيْنَ غَيْرُهُ مِنْهُ, then where do the regular individuals that you and I feature in this regard? Imam Ghazali rahimahullah said, إِذَا رَأَيْتَ صَغِيرًا, when you see a child, then say to yourself, هَذَا لَمْ يَعْصِ اللَّهَ وَأَنَا عَصَيْتُهُ فَلَا شَكَّ أَنَّهُ خَيْرٌ مِّنِّي. He's pure, he's innocent, he's nafsan zakiyah, he's a sinless soul. He's definitely better than me because he has no liabilities, he has no sin. وَإِذَا رَأَيْتَ كَبِيرًا, and when you see a senior person elder than you, then you say, he's born before me, so he's worshipping Allah before me, hence he's better than me. وَإِذَا رَأَيْتَ عَالِمًا, when you see a learned person, you say, هَذَا عَلِمَ مَا لَمْ أَعْلَمْ وَبَلَغَ مَا لَمْ أَبْلُغْ فَكَيْفَ أَكُونُ مِثْلًا. He's committed the Quran to memory, how can I be equal to him? He's definitely greater than me. And when you see a sinful person, then say to yourself, هَذَا عَصَى اللَّهَ بِجَهْلٍ وَأَنَا عَصَيْتُ اللَّهَ بِعِلْمٍ فَحُجَّةُ اللَّهِ عَلَيَّ أَكْبَرُ. He has probably committed the sin unknowingly, unwittingly, unintentionally, without having the knowledge. And I perpetrate the crime despite knowing the knowledge, despite having the knowledge and understanding it's forbidden. So the proof of Allah against me is stronger than the proof of Allah against him. And when you see a disbeliever, Imam Ghazali takes it to that point, Abu Hamid al-Ghazali rahimahullah, when you see a disbeliever, then say, Asa a Yuslim. It's highly possible before death, Allah will give him iman. فَيَكُونُ غَدًا هُوَ مِنَ الْمُقَرَّبِينَ. So he will be amongst the close people on the day of Qiyamah. وَأَمَّا أَنَا فَعَسَىٰ أَن يُضِلَّنِيَ اللَّهِ. And it's possible that I could slip and I could lose my balance before death and deprived of iman. فَأَكُونُ غَدًا مِنَ الْمُبْعَدِينَ. And I would be deprived on the day of Qiyamah. In essence, I'm saying pride is repugnant, it's deplorable, it's detestable. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, anyone who has an iota of pride in his heart will be deprived of iman. Understand, the correct definition of pride is the perception that you superior and others are inferior. While pride in all forms is wicked, evil and nasty, the pride of piety and nobility is the most evil of all forms of pride. May Allah protect us from every form of pride.